Hello everybody and welcome back. Let's talk about the problem nth magical number. I'm going to explain the binary search approach in detail along with the intuitions of how I actually thought about it, how to code it up in Python 3, and a couple of observations and logic you can keep in mind for later as well. Alright, so let's quickly talk about the problem statement first. We're given three different integer values, n, a, and b. And the goal of this problem is to return the nth number which is divisible by either a or b. So this will make more sense with an example. Let's say that the a is 2 and the b is 3. Cool. In that case, we have a sequence like 2, 3, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10, and so on and so forth. What it says is all of these numbers in the sequence are either multiples of 2 or 3 or both. So we can have multiples of 2 as in 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Multiples of 3 as in 3, 6, 9, blah, 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 and both of their common multiples as well. So 6, 12, 18, so on and so forth. And now the question is, given this a and b as 2 and 3, can you find me the answer for n equals to 1, say? And what it means is, given a and b, given the sequence, which we'll have to find by the way ourselves, this yellow thing is not given to us, only a and b are, given this a and b, and given n equals to 1, can you find me the first number in the sequence? So it's pretty simple. You can just look at the first number, which is going to be 2, and return as is. Then what would be the answer for n equals to 2, where we want to find the second number in the sequence? Well, again, you can look at the sequence and the number is 3, so we'll return that. Now, what if I ask the question n equals to 6? Again, you can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and you will find the sixth element inside of the sequence is 9. So pretty simple if we have the sequence, but the issue is we are not given the sequence, which is what makes this problem so interesting. All right, so I'll go over a couple of intuitions and observations I took when I was first solving the question. And the first thing that came to my mind was maybe we want to use a priority queue. And the entire idea was that, you know, because we have to find the nth number, which is either divisible by A or B, I can start by inserting elements A and B into the list, and then trying to find all of the multiples on A and B, and I'll keep on adding them to the priority queue. This was at least my first idea. However, we want to look at N. The input N has a constraint that it could be up to 10 to the power 9, which means that any order of N or N log N or anything above that will not work. We want something of the sort of N log N, perhaps. Which brings me to my actual idea. In these kind of questions where n equals to 10 to the power 9 at max, we want to think about binary search. And this is like, now we have figured out that because n is so large, we'll use binary search. We have a sort of general direction in mind. Yeah. But binary search we know, but what now? Like, how do we apply binary search to this? And the goal is to really find the nth number, but how do we do that? That is now the biggest question. I know I'll use binary search. Sure, I'll use binary search, but how do I find the nth number? Let's talk about the observations and logic. Let's say given a equals to 2, b equals to 3, the same sequence. This yellow thing again is, by the way, not provided to us. Now we had n equals to 1 giving us 2, n equals to 2 giving us 3, n equals to 6 giving us 9. Standard stuff, we've already seen that. In these kind of questions where we are not really sure where to go, where we have this binary search that we have in mind, but no real direction of how to proceed, what I often suggest is try flipping this problem on its own head. Try reversing the entire thing and see what happens. So instead of going from n to a particular value, of finding the nth value, how about this? How about you look at a value x and try to find the n from it? For example, if you look at the value 10, this is 10 something, I'm going to input the function now, and I want this function to return me the index 7, right? This is one index, by the way. So I want it to return me 7, which is going to tell me the position of 10. Similarly, if I give it the input as 4, I want it to be able to say that, you know what, 4 is the third element inside of the sequence, right? So the question I'm asking is, first of all, is there a way to go from x to n, not from n to x, but x to n? And even if we figure that out, okay, what is going to be the next step? Like, what do we do of that? Here's the thing. We have a sequence of multiples of either A or B. And the goal is to find the position or the nth position inside of that sequence. So how about this? Since the position is dependent upon the number of multiples of A and B and some combination of that, how about this? How about I ask the question, what are the number of multiples of A? I'll also ask the question, what are the number of multiples of B? Both of these can somehow give me the general position of where I can find the nth guy. So let's take an example again. A equals to 2 gives us 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, so on and so forth. B equals to 3 gives us 6, 9, 12, and so on and so forth. One thing which we'll quickly notice is that 2 and 3 will have certain common factors. In fact, you'll see that 6 and 12 and 18 will get repeated again and again. Now 6, 12, and 18 are nothing but the LCM of 2 and 3. This is a key point inside of the solution. So now we've figured out that a position is defined by a combination of A, B, and an LCM of A and B. So what we can do is mathematically write it down, saying that, okay, given the random input as X, like this is some random input we'll give to the function, and this function will be able to tell us what is the position of that value X inside of the sequence. So we can do X by A plus X by B minus the common of LCM of A and B. So what we're doing is finding the multiples of A, finding the multiples of B, and removing all of those multiples which have been repeated, because we don't want to recount the same multiples again and again. And with this, the first problem is solved. We know now how to go from X to N, right? We're first going from N to X. Now we can go from X to N. But the second problem still remains. What do we do now? So just a quick recap of what we know, right? We know that we have to use binary search because n is too large. Writing it down, n has a like limit of 10 to the power 9, and a and b have a limit of 4 into 10 to the power 4. Very weird looking constraint, but sure. And given the random input as x, we can return its position. That is something we've already figured out. So what if we run a binary search over 1, n to the power 18? See, what this binary search will do is it will suggest us inputs. This binary search will move around and will give us inputs X. And this X is something we can pass on to the function we already described over here, which we can return the position. So binary search moves here and there, generates X. And then once we have the X, we can pass it to this function before, and we can convert this X to an N. But now what? Well, since we have the n with us for that particular x, we can compare, hey, is this position too high or too low? Okay, this may seem a bit too weird and a bit too theoretical, so we'll actually take an example, as was suggested by one of my viewers in the last video, which involved binary search. Let's take an example, all right? We'll take a very simple example with a equals to 2, b equals to 3, and n equals to 4. Now, I'm going to set low equals to 1. Since this is a binary search question, we'll discuss low, high, and min. Low equals to 1 and high equals to 20. Of course, high is actually going to be 10 to the power 18, but I'm going to set it to 20 just for the sake of demonstration. All right. Once we have low and high set, we can figure out the medium, which is going to be 20 plus 1 by 2, which is going to give us 10. Now, given the input as 10, this is going to be our x, right? Given the input as m, which is the x, can you return me the position of 10 inside of the sequence? Right. So what we'll do is we'll look at 10, and then we'll go 10 by 2 is 5, 10 by 3 is 3, and 10 by 6, which is the LCM of 2 and 3, is 1. Using this formula, we get 7. So it says, what it says is, given the input as 10, given the x as 10, 10 is at the 7th position. But what is the position asked for us? What is the position we want to return actually? We want to return the 4th position. And this gives us 7th position, which means that 10 is too much. So we want to reduce it. We want to reduce the search space in the binary search. And what we can do is reduce the high to 10. This is standard binary search stuff now. All right. So now we have low as 1, high as 10. What now? We'll figure out the mid, which is going to be 1 plus 10 by 2, 5. And now we'll ask the question again. What is the position of 5 inside of the sequence? All right, so 5 by 2 is going to be 2. 5 by 3 is going to be 1. And 5 by 6 is going to be 0. So we have 2 plus 1 minus 0, which gives us 3. So it says that the position of 5, right? The value x, when we give the input as 5, is going to return us the position of 3, which is 2 less as compared to what we want. We want the position at 4, yeah? So what we'll do is, we'll now increase the low to mid plus 1. So this 3 becomes 3 plus 1, 4 over here. So now we can again compute n equals to 7, and we can compute 3 plus 2 minus 1, which is 4. This is exactly what we want, yeah? If you notice, there's a small issue over here. M equals to 7 tells us that 7 is going to be the answer for n equals to 4. I mean, this looks perfect, right? This is a small issue. 7 is nowhere to be found in the sequence of 2 and 3. So let me actually show you. We'll go way behind. If you look at this, what is the fourth position? If you see 1, 2, 3, 4. So fourth position is actually 6, but not 7. 7 is actually nowhere in the sequence. So there's an implementation level detail which we'll have to keep in mind. It's a very small change, but a super important one. Right? But if you realize this much, if you realize the logic of this part, then everything should be super simple. All right, enough talking, let's actually get to coding. All right, so we'll go ahead and start the coding. And the first thing we want to do is get the LCM. Yeah, so we'll get the LCM, which is going to be LCM of two numbers A and B is going to be, what is the LCM defined as? So we can return A times B divided by the GCD of A comma B. Cool. This is how we can find the LCM. One more thing that we had to find was get the position. Given the input as X, A and B, can you return me the position of X? How did we do that? We can return X by A. Damn it. All right. We can return X by A plus X by B minus X by the LCM of A comma B. Super simple, something we've already seen before. Again, like these simple one-liner functions are so important. Like to get to that point, we had to do so much of logic and understanding, but the code becomes very simple once we get that. All right, now how about high, low and high? So low is going to start from 1 and the high is going to be 10 to the power 18. I'm going to do 10 to the power 18 plus 1 just because. And we'll say while low is less than high, do some computations. And at the end, we'll return low. Cool? Because we want the lowest possible value, which corresponds to a particular index. We'll come to that very soon. All right, what do we do in minor research? The first thing we'll do is extract out the mid, which is going to be low plus high by 2. If you are in languages like C, C++, or Java, make sure to instead do low plus high minus low by 2. Otherwise, it would cause an integer overflow when you do high plus low by 2. Now that we have the mid, what do we do of that? Going back to the slides, once we have the mid, we were able to find its position. So let's get the position, which is going to be get position of the current m with A and B supplied. Now what do? If the position is equals to the end given as a target, then I'll come to this very soon. We'll pass it for now, but I'll come back to this. If the position, by the way, is lesser than, so if the position is lesser than n, then we'll say low becomes mid plus 1. Otherwise, we'll say high becomes mid. All right, so why did I skip over this position equals to n? That's because we'll have this case over here. When m equals to 7, we'll end up with the perfect value of n equals to 4. This is exactly what we wanted, but what it's going to do is going to return m as 7. This is something we don't really want. What do we want instead? We want the lowest possible value. We want the lowest possible value, which has n equals to 4. This is why when we have this position equals to n, we really won't do anything. We won't do anything at all. I still want the lowest possible value. I still want the lowest possible value, which corresponds to this value 4. And if you realize something, this is just the code of bisect left in Python. I'll link to the resources down below, and it's super amazing. Like, it's super simple idea, because we don't want to return m equals to 7 as the result. We want the lowest possible value, and that is what we'll return. So this condition is actually pretty much useless. All right, finally, we have a return L. Now we can go ahead and run this code. Cool. So we'll run on some sample test cases, and there is one more issue that we'll quickly fix. So since the answer may be very large, we have to return it 10 to the power 9 plus 7 modulo. So we'll modulo it with 10 to the power 9 plus 7. All right, I think we're finally done. Let's go ahead and do a quick sanity check, and we'll submit this. Cool, so we get it accepted with the runtime of 32 milliseconds. All right, so this is it for the problem, nth magic number. If you want more of these high quality visual explanations of LeetCode solutions, subscribe. And as always, thank you so much for watching.